another tune, I guess, maybe a ballad. Do you know about Chelsea Bridge? Oh, man. Or In a Sentimental Mood?
Yeah, it's In a Sentimental Mood.
Okay, what key would you like to do that?
D minor?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
clinics guys normally do, but I did a thing recently for this company called My Music Masterclass, where it's really cheap, and it's I'm not stammering. They edited all that out of the video, but it's just me talking about reharmonization, and it's pretty cheap, and it's a pretty good series. But it's an online course, and it's like I did two classes, and both of them together with all the PDFs of all the stuff to talk about. One is on modal reharmonization, kind of like how to take it out, kind of like basically analyzing Coltrane and Michael Brecker and that kind of thing. And the other one is on reharmonizing over 2-5-1s. So, and it's pretty interesting and concise, and it's pretty advanced harmonically. But if that's something you're interested in, it's better than me talking about it, I think. It's just go there, because it's concise, and it also has, you know, you can actually look and see, like where the rhythm section plays one chord, and all to like play like C minor, like you're playing modally C minor, like just like one in time, one, two, one, two, three, four. Like, you know, going C minor to D minor would just be playing over Dorian, you know, like, So, you know, back and forth, it's kind of like establishing a modal tonality. If you go the other way, if you go like C minor to B flat minor, even though they're playing all C minor, you're basically establishing a Phrygian tonality. Or by going, you know, C minor to F minor, you're basically kind of establishing an Aeolian tonality, and you have the harmonic freedom to do any of that if you're playing. And it's just basically, or even just by doing simple things like by going C minor to F7, even though they're just playing C minor, you know, like. So I mean, just, you know, establishing like a little bit of harmonic. You know, I mean, if you're just a beginning player, it doesn't make any sense. But if you're interested in something like that, it's a pretty good course. And they also have classes on there, like Berganti has done one, and Dave Liebman has done a couple, and I've never seen him. Tom Scott just did one. I haven't seen that one either. But and Kenny Warner and I believe Schofield. They're pretty reasonably priced, and it's better than a Skype lesson, because you're getting everything the guy can think of to teach, and it's edited, it's concise, and it's you can go back to it and look at as many times as you want, you know, and you own the thing. So it's a pretty good class. I recommend it really highly. As I would recommend this shop and Daddario Reeds. I've been using them for 30 years. We're going to play another tune right now, and then I'll answer any questions after this tune. We're going to play, I'm going to kind of demonstrate a little bit of, like, you know, reharmonization over a set of 2-5s, a little bit. I mean, the thing is, if you do anything too much, if you do any reharmonization, it just sounds like you're playing the wrong keys. So, but I mean, a little bit can be really exciting, and it could be like, when you ever hear, like when I was young, I would hear like Coltrane do something. I go, man, what is that? And then I started, kind of trying to slowly figuring out what it was, and or at least my impression of what it is. Okay, so what is this thing?
Yeah.
Called Love? We'll be right back. play sax?
Yes.
Awesome. Well, you know, thanks. Thank you to Mark for Overton for bringing me to here to St. Louis. And I just thought, you know, and coming to see this great play. We could just keep playing. Is there anybody have any questions? Yes, sir.
When did you start playing?
Well, I played clarinet when I was a kid. And then I switched to sax kind of pretty much as soon as I played sax. I liked it better than I liked clarinet. But I still play clarinet, but not very, you know, I mean, not as well. I think I play saxophone a lot better. But I started playing sax about my sophomore year in high school. So if you practice, you know, no telling how good you could get. As good as you want to be, really. You'd be the best in the world if you try hard enough. What do you guys want to play?
Thank you.
Catalana.
Cool.
Which one's that?
That's that.
Yeah, listen. Yeah,
one of those.
Quiet nights, something like that?
Yeah, but how about either Wave or Tristan?
Sure, either one.
Which one would you like?
Tristan?
Okay. B flat or A?
B flat?
No, I mean, it's originally.
Tony.
Huh?
Tony's got it.
That's the drummer. Okay. B flat. Vamp and minor.
Thank you.
thank all of you guys for coming out, and thank Mark and thanks for supporting this store whenever you can. People don't realize with the if you go across the country, music stores are literally closing everywhere you go. They're coming by the way of record stores, unless we all. But we need music stores, you know, and unless we all do whatever we can to support music stores, especially one that caters to saxophones, if you don't do everything you can, you know, I mean, everybody's looking to save every penny they can, and maybe you can get something a little bit cheaper if you wait 5 days on the internet. I mean, it's not going to be that much, and if you don't, we all need to do what we can to support music stores, especially ones like great ones like this. So I want to thank Mark and thank you for coming here and doing what you can to support. Time I had like 400 albums, and over 100 of them were Coltrane, and it was like a really depressing day when I realized that I bought every Coltrane record that had been released, and then I started trying to get live tapes, and like a new Coltrane record to me was like, you know, it's nothing like it. And it's really sad when you think, wow, this guy's died, and as much as he's recorded, as great as he was, you realize how under-recorded he was, and there was like live, he played here in St. Louis. With Billy Higgins, they did two, I believe, or maybe that was Denver, but somewhere, and that concert doesn't exist on tape, and I know, you know, all that stuff is like gold, there's a lot of great players alive today, but like somebody like now with it, Mark, you look at like Michael Brecker and every time he ever practiced, somebody recorded it. I mean, there's recordings of him trying out reeds, and you know, compare that to like how under-recorded the great players. I mean, to me, the greatest two saxophone players of all time were Charlie Parker and John Coltrane. And then there's everybody else, and that covers a lot of. There's also a lot of great, great saxophone players. It's just maybe not, in my opinion, you know, not as great as those guys, those two. But you could listen. I mean, listen to Coltrane. Every period of Coltrane, he was. You know, just to me, like, you know, the greatest. I'm like, I don't get that sense. Even Michael Brecker was another great saxophonist, but I don't get that, the same sense of relaxation, you know, or that I get. I mean, if you really concentrate and really listen to Train, it's almost like, it seems like God is speaking to you. And if you I remember making tapes of Brecker solos, and I mean, I love Michael Brecker. But it was kind of like that feeling like you did too much cocaine, you know, you just kind of like, not that any amount is I just don't, I don't know. But anyway, but that kind of feeling, you know, this feeling of like too much coffee, you know, it's like so intense and so great. And whereas Coltrane would play that intense, but it would be kind of like a, with more of a spiritual experience. To me, he personally spoke to me, and I really liked him probably more than anybody else, still do. Any other questions? Yes, sir. No, they didn't. Hopefully next time. I just talked to Kevin Guerin, and I was supposed to go by and sign up and become an official artist endorser. I was a Rico endorsed artist when Boozy and Hawks named it, and then somehow because I signed up as an artist when in Germany with the head of the relations there, that when I moved to California, they gave me so many reeds. They gave me a shopping cart full of reeds, and I bought an extra suitcase, huge, and that was back when you could have huge suitcases. Yeah. There was no such thing as oversized, and it was 80 pounds of reeds. They gave me all the reeds I could carry, and I was like, you know, so they gave
just
me.
Just ran out last week, right?
They lasted me 3 years. I lasted me 3 years, and when I went to go back, Boozy and Hawks had been sold, and I wasn't, somehow I didn't make the cut, and then I was gonna, you know, so I was never really an official and endorsing. But I know he said I do a lot of studio work. I'm actually kind of stopping. And trying to do just play more jazz and I have a bunch of records out on this great label called Positone, and they're from out of New York, and they actually got, in fact, a June issue of Jazz Times are doing a feature article on me, and you know, I have another record. I have some records here. I bet I actually for sale if anybody wants. They're for $10 if anybody's interested. One is a record I did for Positone. It's got a lot of my original tunes. And another one is all standards I did with a great piano player, the great Alan Broadbent. And that's on another label, and which is kind of, I forgot about it. I had done it, and then the guy just released that too. So I actually have kind of two records out at the same time. And then sometime in probably June or July, I'll have another record I did with Positone. So.
Anyway, I had a read question.
Yes.
And I will put in a book. I own all the records.
Oh, you do? Great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And they're great. They're absolutely great.
Well, that's very nice of you, sir. What's your read question?
Like medium read, medium opening most of the time?
I use a Recode Jazz Select 3 medium. And you know, and I've also liked other kind of reads. I also, when you get into New York, no offenses, I'm not official. I'll never use another read. As soon as I'm official endorsing, but so sometimes I've been using the when I go to New York, Roberto's makes reads. They're so expensive. They're like $5. They're $5 a read if you get 10 at a time. They're $50 for a box, but they're really good, and they're hand cut, and their cane is good.
Well, I was thinking more of just. What kind? I mean, what Berganzi's is a really big seven, right?
This is about a seven. This is a Tone Master, an auto link, an old auto link from the 40s.
So kind of a medium to medium opening facing.
It's a seven. It measures at a seven star.
Yeah.
And I use like a middle three.
Yeah.
Strength three.
That's what I thought. And that's across all the horns?
No, I use I use very hard reeds on soprano, and I use a Selmer. I've used the E for Selmer a long time. Lately, I found a G that I liked, but I use a metal Selmer on soprano, on alto. I'm also going to be coming. They're coming out with Eric Falcon, who is involved in making this Saxquest mouthpiece. Is going to make a signature mouthpiece for me, and it was supposed to be ready last year, and I got involved with some other things. But we're working on kind of designing a. Kind of a cross between an old Duke Hollywood Dukoff and an old auto link that's not too bright without the rollover baffle, because I think you can get all enough brightness without the rollover baffle. Like a lot of the mouthpieces that have rollover baffles are really good to immediately get a good sound, but when you really start practicing on them and you start practicing long tones, you kind of hit a wall, mm-hmm. and they have you get a lot of brightness initially. But then when you really start practicing, or if you push them, whereas a mouthpiece without a rollover baffle, I don't mind like the a step baffle as much, or even like a really bright mouthpiece. I mean, some guys like playing that way and have great sounds. I mean, so there's a lot of different ways of playing, and saxophone can sound different. We all sound different on saxophone. And that's one thing that's so great about the saxophone. It's like everybody really kind of has their own voice. And... you know, I mean, it's like if you look, you can even look at somebody's waveform. That's why it's saxophone. We can't double ourselves. Like when you go to record, it sounds like one guy chorused. Unless you're out of tune, or unless you use, you know, unless you change everything. Like if, you know, you have to I've tried to do big band record recordings where I did every part, and I literally will take two different completely opposite mouthpieces. I've even taken a straight tenor, like a straight tenor. A straight alto, and you know, and then tried to really mix it up, and it still sounds like one guy chorused, no matter what you do. So, anyway, I guess that's about it. Oh, thanks a lot. What little water would be good.
Thank you, sir.
We're gonna play another tune. Some kind of standard with changes. You know, Sweet and Lovely, or Like Someone Loved?
Sure.
Can I do that? That's a tune by Jimmy Van Heusen. All right, wait, actually, do you know Emily? Okay. This is by Jimmy Van Heusen. It's entitled Like Someone Loved. which one?
Countdown or Giant Steps or Central Park West or
You want to do Countdown?
I'd love to.
Do you know the banding and everything? A really hard tune, but we're gonna play.
mindful of the piano playing.
Request. You guys.
Yeah.
Okay. them. And, you know, it's great, that nowadays you can go to, you know, almost anywhere, and there's great, jazz players now in every town. It's great. Yes, great. Thanks for playing with me. So play something. What, kind of, what else can, your turn, call it. Beatrix. played saxophone, and my mom went to a record store and you know, said my son plays saxophone. She came home with Cannonball Adderley and a Coltrane record. You know, I started, you know, listening to that stuff, and you know, I before that I was listening to Led Zeppelin. I have a fusion band we play, we're getting ready to record. This with a drummer from Tool, and I actually know Marco Ciccoli really well, because he always comes to our gigs. He's been to about four of them, and he's I guess he's one of the you know him. You worked with him at all?
Yeah, he's a trip.
Yeah.
We go out and have food afterwards.
Yeah, he's
talking.
Great guy. Yeah, he's a great guy. Well, anyway, it's a the drummer is a guy named Danny Carey. He plays with a band called Tool, and I play Mitch Foreman, and we've been together about three or four years. We play like once a month at a place called the Baked Potato. And it's really like fusion. It's kind of a cross between late Coltrane and Led Zeppelin. In fact, we play no quarter. I play the soprano, you know, it's like kind of Led Zeppelin kind of stuff. But, you know, my records are more straight ahead right now. But I hope to record that band like soon. In fact, somebody wants to pay for us to record too, so that's nice. If you guys want to play another tune, you're getting tired? We're sort of long set. let's play, how about Invitation? Cool? Thank you.
Thank you.